4-Methylcyclohexanemethanol Acute Toxicity to Daphnia, and its effects on general esterase and glutathione S-Transferase activity in fat. Okay, so why do I choose this project? So back in Fathead, Minnows, well, they provide some toxicity information for that. The 96-hour LC50, which is the lethal concentration that kills 50% of the population, was 57.4 ppm. And then the no observable effect concentration, 25 ppm. Generally classified as harmful to aquatic organisms. So right after this spill, a group was organized called independent research where he tested the 48-hour EC50 and got 50 ppm instead of the 100 or 98.1 ppm that Eastman Chemical Company originally reported. Again, his research was preliminary. I couldn't find a published article for that, but he did report it at a conference. And then the no observable effect concentration was 6.25, again, way below Eastman's value of 50 ppm. There were a couple other discrepancies in the manufacturer's material safety data sheet as well. And then you can see there, just in the government organizations that analyzed this chemical, you have the CDC initially giving a safety threshold of 1 ppm. And then the WVTAP came along and said, okay, well, we need to lower that a magnitude because that's not as well established. So they lowered it to 0.112 ppm. And then the executive department of West Virginia said, okay, well, you guys clearly you're not agreeing on this. And so they lowered that one magnitude further to 0.010 ppm. So again, there's not a lot of agreement on how safe this chemical was. So what were our objectives? Our objectives were to verify, first of all, verify the 48-hour EC50 for Daphnia. And then we also wanted to expand our project a little bit further to look at some sublethal sublethal effects, specifically determining the effects of MCHM on the activity levels of two detoxification enzyme systems, general esterase and glutathione S-transferase. We did that by exposing them to MCHM for 96 hours. Crude MCHM actually has some variation in its composition, so we decided to use pure MCHM instead to kind of eliminate that variable. So for Daphnia, just for the culture, we kept them in a lint M4 medium, which is a standard medium for Daphnia toxicity studies, just made up about 26 trace elements. 16-8 light dark photo period, 20 degrees Celsius, and we gave them an algae yeast mixture. And you can see over there on the right, that's our culture setup. And that Daphnia is actually one of ours that we got to take a picture of with the biology department's high resolution microscope camera. So that was kind of cool. So for the actual exposure, we got about 10 test concentrations, which we isolated by doing a pretty broad range of concentrations. And so we looked at where it was actually having an effect, and so we kind of narrowed that down further. And in the actual range, we kind of concentrated the test concentrations in the middle where we actually expect the EC50 to be. So right around 100 ppm, we had a lot more concentrations. And out further, we expect to get 100% mortality over at 162 and 0% mortality over at the bottom in the controls. We kind of had fewer test concentrations down there. We had 3 subsets per concentration, 10 Daphnia per subset. And then, of course, we exposed them for 48 hours. And then we repeated that 3 times for the final set of concentrations that we came up with. So the effective response was a mobilization. We based it on some fairly well-established protocols that are out there. Just so if they're moving their appendages, but they can't really swim, that's pretty much considered immobilized. And we put all that data into an analysis software, and that spit out our effective concentrations. So this is what we actually got, and you can see what I meant there by concentrating our data points in the middle, right where you get the highest slope. Whereas on the far sides, there's fewer data points. And so that's what we really want, to isolate the EC50 really well. We want the data points in the middle. And you see you get that we got that nice sigmoidal curve, which you expect to see from a dose response curve. So on the y-axis, you see you have percent immobilization, and on the x, you have the concentration of MCHM. And so this is the actual values we got. We reported the EC10 and EC90 as well, but the important one was the EC50, which we got 91.6 ppm and a 95% confidence interval of 83.1 to 99.3. And so you see the 98.1 value that Eastman originally reported for the EC50 just barely made it in there at the end. So it is not, we did not get a significant difference from Eastman's value. Again, it's just important to note that we did use pure MCHM and not crude MCHM, like Dr. Welton did in his research and Eastman used in their research as well. So that's what we did for the Daphnia. Now we moved on to the fathead minnows. The culture, fairly similar, 21 degrees Celsius, 16-8 light dark photo period, 100 ppm calcium carbonate. And that's why the water looks pretty cloudy. It usually was because of the calcium carbonate. And then we kept the dissolved oxygen above 5 ppm and fed them twice a day. So for the actual exposure, we kept the same culture conditions. It was a non-lethal 96-hour exposure. So we kind of based that upon the estimated maximum concentration in the Elk River to make. So we wanted to have environmentally relevant concentrations. So the estimated maximum was 21 ppm. If you look at the bottom there, our concentrations were 20, 13, and 6, and of course a control. And you can see all of those are below the no observable effect concentration reported by Eastman, which was 25. So again, we're testing this at sublethal levels, seeing if we can see an effect on enzyme activity. Here's our exposure tank set up. So at the end of the 96-hour exposure period, we sacrificed them with tricane methane sulfonate. recorded the sex, mass, and length. And if you look at the mass and the length there, you see the males 3.9 to 2.5, 3.9 for males, 2.5 for females, and for the length it's 7.9 for males and 7.0 for females. And so you can see there's some sexual dimorphism there. But with the fish as small as they were, it was pretty hard to tell the sex. And so that's what I was illustrating over there on the right. The way you actually have to sex them is there is pointing to that urogenital extension. If you bend the tail backwards, you can see that on females between the pelvic and pectoral fins, whereas males don't have that. I don't know if you can see it. It's pretty small. Anyway, we dissected them and extracted the viscera, flash froze in liquid nitrogen, and stored the samples at minus 80 until we could move on to the next step. So initially, to prepare our actual protein samples, just kind of a real short summary, homogenize, centrifuge at 10 G, and then collect that supernatant. And that supernatant, which you see there on the bottom, that was our actual protein sample, or our enzyme sample. After that, we had to quantify the protein, and then we divided it via the Bradford method, which I'm sure many of you have used in lab. And then we divided that sample into two aliquots, one for the general esterase assay and one for the glutathione S-transferase assay. So the basic procedure of the assay, each of the enzymes acts on a particular substrate. You see I have PNPA over there for the general esterase and CDNB for the glutathione S-transferase. We put the protein samples in the wells of a microplate and then mix in the substrate, and we put that in a photospectrometer. What happens is the enzyme cleaves the substrate into some products that absorb light at a particular wavelength. And so as it cleaves more product, the sample or the well is going to absorb more light. And so the photospectrometer measures that. And so as it gets further along, the absorbance is going to increase. And we can take the slope of that at the highest point, or the steepest slope, and we go through a series of calculations, and we can convert that into activity. So a steeper slope indicates a higher activity. What we're looking for is differences in activity, really not exact how active the enzymes actually are. And so this is our actual data, or our final results. Here is the activity for general esterase, and you can see there the activity is in micromoles of product per minute per milligram. And then on the x-axis, we have the different concentrations. And then on the top, you have males, and the bottom, females. I can just move on to glutathione S-transferase. So you can see with both of these, the error bars that there are standard error. You can see with these that there's always overlap between the experimental concentrations and the control. So we didn't actually see significant difference in these. We didn't see significant changes in activity. And I'll talk about that in a little bit more in a second. So just to go back, so back to the Daphnia for a second. So the EC50 that we actually got, the EC50 provided by the manufacturer for crude MCHM lies within the 95% confidence interval of our EC50 for pure MCHM. So again, they're not significantly different. So our EC50 kind of upheld the original one provided by Eastman Chemical Company. So again, back to the enzymes, we did not observe an effect on enzymes of detoxification, general esterase or glutathione S-transferase. However, when we looked at the substrates, the normal biological substrates for the enzymes, there was not a lot of similarities between the molecular structure of MCHM and their normal substrates. And so when we actually looked into some other systems, cytochrome P450 is probably a more likely candidate because its normal substrates are more similar to MCHM. However, before you could ever really go that route, one of the big problems is low bioavailability, because MCHM is very poorly soluble. And it's less, it has less an effect of an effect on the Daphnia, but because with the minnows, you have to actually get the toxicant into the systems in equal amounts in all of them, and actually have the body process it, it's a lot more difficult to do that. Bioavailability becomes a lot more important, that you expose each minnow to the same amount. And because the chemical does not dissolve in the water well, it's very difficult to ensure that. So that would have to be addressed before you really moved on to test another detoxification enzyme system. Anyway, that was pretty much the end of our project. Just would like to thank Jihoon, Jung, and Gus Wars both helped us a lot in the lab, going through these lab procedures. Dr. Odin's really helped us as we tried to simplify the making up of ILINT M4. We tried to get 26 trace elements into water, which we had to replace 3 times a week. It's not an easy process, so he helped us simplify that a little bit. Dr. Trott helped us set up the incubators and get our minnow exposures running. And Dr. Corbett helped us with the statistical analysis. So I guess thank them.
So do you have any questions for Jared? If there are no questions, we'll move on to our next project here. Thank you, Jared. So our next project, Jared's a senior. He'll be graduating here very soon, going on to medical school in San Antonio, Texas, I believe. Congratulations, Jared. Our next group, mostly our freshmen, except for Michael. Michael, what year are you in? Yeah, so Michael's a junior. He's going to be going to Andrews University soon in medical laboratory sciences. And then the three ladies, we have Yaland and Vanessa and McKenzie, all three freshmen that are starting a project, and this project will take them 3 years to complete. And I'm going to let them, this is the first time in Southern, in our biology department here, where researchers are actually getting paid to do research, so that's pretty cool. They're getting academic credit, helping to complete their majors, and they're also getting paid to do it at the same time, so that's pretty cool. I'm going to let them tell you about their project.
Hello, there you go. Good evening. As Dr. Thornton said, my name is Michael Baranda, and I am one of the researchers on the Arboretum Project. Katrina Mayer says, time spent amongst trees is never wasted time. This quote might not really impact you on hindsight, but it does impact us researchers on this project, because after going through this project, we believe that trees are pivotal for our ecosystem, for our community, because it not contributes to our overall health, but the overall stability of the community. So trees are really important to us. So try to take time and look at a tree and actually appreciate it for God's creation. Before we go on to the actual project, there are some facts and some things I'd like to cover, especially species and interactions. According to a study done by Mora and some authors, they estimated for there to be about 8.7 million species in the world, and these are already identified species. They calculated this number by obtaining the number of species from these databases and then adding them up all together. Communities are the interactions between these species, all these 8.7 million species across the world. And these interactions include mutualism, predation, and parasitism. So all these species are in the communities. These interactions are what we can define as communities. Lastly, when these communities have more different amount of species or a number of species in these communities, it contributes to the community stability, which essentially means that the community is able to resist or be resilient to changes that can come at the community. The primary purpose for our project is to calculate the species diversity of trees on our main campus. Once we find the species diversity, which what I am currently working on is I will be using the Simpson's Index, which is an equation to find the species diversity on our campus, and to compare that diversity of an undisturbed area, specifically the Oak Ridge Reservation in Tennessee, in eastern Tennessee, so that we can have a comparison between an area that is undisturbed with trees and a disturbed area, which is our campus. Once I have compared the diversities, we can make a plan to plant additional trees to increase our diversity. Also, Southern, as you can see on Wright Hall, the projection, the 125 years, their plan is to plant 125 trees, and with this project, we are able to know what types of species of trees we can plant across campus. Lastly, we are hoping to establish Southern as an arboretum, its official Tennessee arboretum, which an arboretum is an area where plants or trees have species are identified in the area, and the community is able to go to that area and see what species are there.
All right. Hi, my name is Yalen, and I'm going to be talking about what we do when we go out to collect data. So that's a picture of me dragging around George, and George is our cart where we keep all the tools, and it has a wooden top because that's where we lay out the map so that we can write everything down. So we go out and we put numbers on trees so that the trees can be identified by that number. And we measure the diameter at breast height, which is basically the diameter around the trunk of the tree. And soon we're gonna start doing the GPS coordinates for all of the trees with a high precision GPS. And it's gonna get it to within like 4 inches of the tree, which is really precise. And we're gonna be using the global information system, which is the GPS system. It's like a layered map. It produces a layered map. So we want to create a layer that has all the trees on our campus. And then we're going to go back and identify the species of all the trees and put identification tags on them and put the information into a website called Plants Map. All right, so this is a picture of our campus, and it's divided up into quadrants. And here you can see right there, that's the circle when you're driving up. This is Talge, Thatcher, Wright Hall, Linwood, where we are right now. And the yellow outline is all the area that we want to cover. That area is where we want to tag all the trees and identify them. And the red area is what we have already done since mid-January. And we've done 819 trees so far. So I'm just going to walk you through the process of what we go through whenever we approach a tree. This is an American holly on the corner of Wright Hall. So here you can see like the sidewalk to the calf. So that's the tree. And what we do is we find a place on the tree that's not very visible to put the tag so that it's not distracting or too noticeable. So here we have a picture of Michael putting in the tag. And here we have a picture of the tag. So as you can see, it says the number 919, and that's what we identify the tree as. It's like tree number 919. And then on this picture, Vanessa is measuring the diameter and breast height of that tree. And on the picture on the right, Mackenzie is measuring a different tree because she's the one that usually goes through and measures all the trees. The last thing we do is we record the data on the map. So like I said before, the map that I showed you was divided up into quadrants, and we have a blown up map of each quadrant. So the tree that we were talking about is in the corner of Wright Hall. So I write the number 919, which is the number of the tree, and then I put it in the logbook where we have the date, the quadrant, which is quadrant 12, the number of the tree, which is 919, and the diameter at breast height, which is 44.40 centimeters. Here we have an example of the website Plants Map, which is where we want to put all our information into. All the green dots represent a tree. This is the University of Central Florida, so this is their information on the website. And when you click on one of the green dots, it brings you to this page, where you can see pictures of the trees and the different seasons and the information about the tree. And that's what we want to do for our campus.
Hello, I'm Mackenzie Martin, and I'm going to be telling you about our future plans. So in the future, we plan to identify the different trees in our campus, and we also plan for the southern community and the community around us to be able to learn the identities of the trees as well. So what we will be using to identify the trees on campus is a dichotomous key. Now you may be wondering, what's a dichotomous key? Well, it's an identification tool that allows users to figure out the identities of different trees or wildlife like mammals and wildflowers. It consists of a series of questions, and dichotomous means divided into two parts. And so, as I will show in an example, they will ask a specific question and it'll have two answers, and you pick whichever one most relates to the wildlife you are observing. So say that one Sunday morning, maybe this Sunday, our group goes out and we find a tree and we have no idea what this tree is. So we turn to a dichotomous key. As you can see, it begins with an initial question with two answers, and you pick which one is most relevant to the organism you're looking at. So say the tree we're looking at is a conifer, which means it keeps its leaves year-round. So if we were to click on this, it would bring us to another question. This question asks, so are the leaves needle-like? Are they flat and scale-like? And say the leaves are needle-like, we would click on it. This takes us to the next question. Are the needles clustered or are they not clustered? If we clicked clustered, it would take us to this question. So are the clusters, are there 2 to 5 needles, or are the clusters greater than 10? If there were clusters from 2 to 5 needles, we would click on the answer, and it would take us to the identification of this particular tree. This would give us the common name, the scientific name, any backgrounds on this tree that is relevant, its ecological role, etc. So we'll be using something similar to this to figure out the different identities of the trees on our campus. Another portion or part of our future plans is we're going to create QR-coded plaques. These QR-coded plaques are going to be placed on specific trees that we select. They'll be either unique and unusual trees or memorial trees, which will be talked about later. They will also be linked, the QR codes will be linked to Plants Map website, where we have the aerial photo of campus and all the different trees that we have here. So if you were to walk along and you see a tree with one of these plaques, as you can see here, you just get your phone out and go to the QR code and it'll take you to Plants Map. And on Plants Map, we're going to have seasonal pictures of these trees so that any time of the year you can go and figure out the identities of the trees around you. And some trees, some specific species of trees, if they've already been given a QR-coded plaque, there's just going to be a question mark on it with a QR code. And this is sort of to create kind of a living quiz. It allows you to test your knowledge on the trees that you've already walked past by. This is also a great tool where you don't need to be here on campus to learn the trees here. You could be in your dorm room, or your grandparents could be in their living room and they could figure out the tree next to your dorm or whatever.
Hello everyone, my name is Vanessa. And what we really want to do with this project is we want to increase the awareness of the different species of trees that we have here on campus. We want to get the students, the faculty, and most importantly, the community involved in learning about these different types of trees that we have. And we want to create an interactive learning trail where you'll be able to look up, you know, a tree of your choice, and it will kind of lead you in a map. Well, it'll make it create a path for you to see the most types of that certain tree. And we want to do this especially in Forest Lane Trail, where families can go and kids can go up to the trees and learn how to identify them. We want to create this tool so that people can learn how to identify trees and go out and be able to do this wherever they go. And memorial trees, I didn't know we had them on campus, but we actually have 30 of them. And it's when people pay, either alumni or past students, they pay to have a tree in honor of someone. And we want to create special plaques to put on these memorial trees and have and put up a picture of the person and a little bit about them on our Plants Map website. And this is something really special that we want to do for all of the trees that we have here that people don't really know about. And now we will answer any questions that you guys have about our project. Thank you.
Well, the trees are, when the alumni or somebody pays for them, they can pick a tree, or landscaping knows which tree will they have. They can, when we do plant trees, they can have that tree as a memorial, but it will possibly be just one that's already on campus, and then we'll put the plaque on there.
We pick a tree, well, we pick the trunk that's most prominent.
And if we decided as a group that we're going to use up to 3 trunks, and we'll measure the one that is most prominent. And we use a measuring tool specifically for trees. It's basically a measuring tape for it. And we have a pair of calipers that I believe go up to 40 centimeters, which we can measure trees more efficiently with those calipers. To mark a tree?
Yeah, how long it takes?
Since we each divide it our parts of the tagging a tree. So I first will put the place where we put the tag, and then Vanessa will hammer in the tag in the tree while Mackenzie is measuring the diameter at breast height. And then we call out the specific number, and we call that out to Vanessa, and she writes that down on the map and in the logbook. So it roughly takes about 2 to 3 minutes.
Oh, it also depends on where we're at, because there's some parts of campus that there's like 50 trees in one area. So everybody kind of, we try to do the most efficient thing, so we'll go around and we'll divide up the parts in a different way so that we can get those trees done. And then in the other parts where there's only like one tree in front of a building, that's a little bit easier, and we just go through the process.
And we're always constantly doing something. If we ever find ourselves not doing something for a quick minute, we'll move on to somebody else's job if they're not doing something. So we're always constantly tagging trees or measuring them, and we're just passing the tools to each other so that we're always constantly working. I saw another question here.
Yeah. So what's, you're making the product tag, it seems like, what's going to be the remainder of the 3 years we're going to spend that time doing?
The plan is that we will be going, after we covered our area, we'll identify all the trees, and that will probably take the majority of our time because we're still learning, identifying trees. We're not experts yet. We're probably going to have the landscaping department, one of the directors, I believe, there who have planted these trees knows them best. And we're also going to ask Dr. Norsko, who is familiar with identifying trees, and we'll walk around with them to figure out what trees we have on campus. And after we have identified the trees, we will then hopefully establish arboretum and then calculate the species diversities and then move from there. And actually, after identifying the trees, we have a GPS unit that is coming very soon, and we will be using that unit so that we can have the coordinates so that we can locate the trees online or wherever.
And we will probably start identifying trees once spring arrives, really early, so that'll be soon.
Essentially, well, to my knowledge, the diameter is technically the circumference, but Dr. Thorne here to answer that question.
So, like they shared, it's a special measuring tape so that when you go around it, the numbers actually represent the diameter instead of the circumference. That's a really good question. Yeah, that's a good question. All right, thank you very much. Have a good night, everybody. Please put your pieces of paper on the table back there.